Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The CIA War in Kurdistan, The Untold Story of the Northern Front in the Iraq War, by Sam Faddis, narrated by Paul Boehmer. Remember the lessons of history. Remember how often whole peoples have allowed themselves to be persuaded to go to war by wise men, and then been utterly destroyed by the very enemy they agreed to attack. Remember how many statesmen have helped raise new leadership to power, and then been overthrown by their own protégés. Remember how often leaders have chosen to treat their friends like slaves, and then perished in the revolutions caused by their idiotic methods. How many powerful men have craved to dominate the world, and by overreaching, have lost everything they once possessed. Xenophon, commander of the 10,000, a group of Greek mercenaries forced to retreat from Iraq through Kurdistan to the Black Sea in 401 BC. The 10,000 were stranded near contemporary Baghdad when the military invasion in which they were engaged fell apart, and they were abandoned to their fate. On their own, without outside assistance and against a host of foes arrayed against them, the 10,000 succeeded in fighting their way out and returning to Greece. Preface. On my wall hangs a photo. In it are three people standing on the banks of the Tigris. Citizen, my senior reports officer, me, and Hans, my deputy. We are all wearing bullet-resistant vests. We are all carrying weapons. We are all standing in the middle of a city, disintegrating into chaos. In 2004, I went to headquarters for an awards ceremony. Everyone who had been in Kurdistan during the period of 2002 to 2003 was to be recognized. With my colleague, Tim, who commanded one of the CIA teams in northern Iraq, I had put together the list of officers in our bases who should be decorated and what decorations they should receive. We agreed that everyone who had been in country should be decorated, and also chose two officers from each base to be singled out for special recognition above everyone else. Standing in line at that awards ceremony, I noticed a couple of things. First, there were at least 100 people being given medals who had never spent a day in country. Second, there were people who were not being recognized at all. Citizen was not present. After the ceremony, I asked about Citizen and some other officers. Eventually, reluctantly, I was advised that the list I had provided had been lost. So headquarters had built a new list, including those names that they could recall from the teams in Iraq. Some people were left off the list inadvertently. For some time thereafter, I corresponded with headquarters from my new station in the Middle East, attempting to get them to rectify their error and recognize those officers who had been inadvertently omitted from the list of honorees. Eventually, I received a not particularly subtle message from the chief of the Near East and South Asia Division telling me the matter was closed and that I should discontinue my efforts to have someone address the situation. Shut up. Move on. The issue was no longer open for discussion. Iraq was in flames. The U.S.'s legacy, the direct result of the coalition provisional authorities' bad decision-making, had been civil war. Headquarters had no interest now in talking about our operations in Iraq in 2002 to 2003, or in the men and women who so bravely and exceptionally carried them out. They wanted to put it all in the rearview mirror and forget about it. This book is my effort to make sure that never happens. Introduction. On December 30th, 2006, Saddam Hussein, one-time ruler of Iraq, was hanged by the neck until dead on the orders of an Iraqi tribunal. The specific crime for which he was executed was the mass murder of 148 Shia men and boys in the village of Dajail in retaliation for the attempted assassination of Saddam in 1982. In the larger context of what Saddam did throughout his reign, the Dajail murders were hardly of note. No one knows how many people had been killed under Saddam's regime, but estimates run as high as 500,000. One mass grave alone is estimated to hold the remains of 15,000 people. No one paid a higher price under Saddam, or more completely refused to abandon the fight to depose him, than the Kurdish people. The origins of the Kurds are not completely clear, but they have inhabited the area of northern Iraq for a very long time. When Xenophon, the Greek general, made his famous fighting retreat out of what is now Iraq and back to Greece, he had to cut his way through the Kurds to do so. His account of that march leaves no doubt as to the ferocity of the warriors he faced. During the Iran-Iraq War, 1980-1988, the Kurdistan Democratic Party, KDP, in the mountains of northern Iraq, allied itself with Iran in the hope that it could leverage Iranian support to achieve independence and form a free Kurdish nation. The Barzani clan, which under Masoud Barzani formed the bulk of the leadership of the KDP, paid dearly for this betrayal. In 1983, Iraqi forces, acting under the direct orders of Saddam Hussein, rounded up more than 8,000 Barzani males, many just boys, executed them, and bulldozed them into mass graves. The first of their bodies were not found until 2005. Most remain unaccounted for to this day. In the face of this atrocity, the world did nothing. Far worse was yet to come. In 1988, Saddam launched what was called the Anfal campaign. Between February and September of 1988, Iraqi forces conducted a systematic, genocidal campaign against the Kurds in northern Iraq, involving sustained aerial bombardment and the widespread use of chemical weapons. Under the command of Saddam's cousin, General Ali Hassan al-Majid, Chemical Ali, 100,000 Kurdish men, women, and children were killed. This included the slaughter of over 5,000 people in the town of Halabja in a single day with a combination of nerve agents and mustard gas. Survivors of the widespread chemical attacks during the Anfal campaign were captured and interrogated. Males between 15 and 70 were then shot and dumped into mass graves. By the time the campaign ended, in fall 1988, 90% of Kurdish towns and villages had been wiped from the face of the earth. The United States, more fixated on the threat posed by Iran than Saddam, took no action to stop the slaughter. In 1991, Saddam invaded Kuwait, which he considered to be a historical part of Iraq. His army quickly overran that small nation, but was subsequently crushed by a coalition consisting largely of American military forces. Encouraged by the defeat and by the rhetoric of President George H.W. Bush, who seemed to be calling for Saddam's ousting, the Kurds once again rose in rebellion. Once again, the Kurds were crushed, along with Shia forces which similarly rose against Saddam in the south. 20,000 more Kurds died as Iraqi artillery, armor, and helicopters slaughtered those seeking Saddam's ouster. 2 million Kurds fled into the mountains to escape certain death. The U.S. and its coalition allies stood by and watched. Then, in mid-April 1991, the United States, the United Kingdom, and France, appalled by the slaughter, imposed a no-fly zone over northern Iraq. Buoyed by the knowledge that Iraqi air power could no longer be brought to bear against their forces, the Kurds stabilized the battlefront and imposed a de facto border between what was now, for all intents and purposes, an independent Kurdistan and Saddam's Iraq. The so-called Green Line ran generally southeast, from a point near Zako in the northwest, to the Iranian border. Erbil, the largest city in Kurdistan, lay just north of the line. Kirkuk, a city with a mixed Kurdish and Arab population, lay just below it within the area under Saddam's control. And so the situation stood until 2002. Chapter 1. 9/11. I found out about the 9/11 terrorist attacks the way everyone else did. I watched it on TV. I was sitting in my office at CIA headquarters in Langley, riding a desk and hating life. I had been back in country for 60 days, and already I couldn't wait to go overseas again. No real case officer wants to be stateside. He wants to be in the field where the ops are. It was morning. I was reading traffic coming in from field stations around the world. Outside my office at the entrance to our group area, there was a television mounted on the wall. I heard a number of people crowding around the television. I heard them say something about a plane striking the World Trade Center in New York. I got up and walked out of my office to see what was going on. And just as I did so, I saw on the television screen a second aircraft hit the World Trade Center. It was instantaneously clear to me, as it was to everyone else watching the broadcast around the world, that what we were seeing was not an accident, but a deliberate act of terror. It felt like I had been punched in the gut. Not just because of the loss of life and the brutality of the act, but because I knew it was all so preventable. I had been working for CIA for 13 years by the time 9/11 happened. I had spent all of that time as a case officer. From day one, I had spent the overwhelming majority of my time working counterterrorism and weapons of mass destruction. I had, like everybody else that I knew who was working the problem, by the late 1990s, an overwhelming sense that the terrorist threat to the United States was increasing daily, and we were doing virtually nothing to combat it. One case will illustrate precisely what I mean. 3 years before 9/11, I was assigned to a Middle Eastern station. Station is the CIA office in a particular country. That's old terminology borrowed from the British. Like virtually everything else that pertains to our human intelligence collection apparatus. I was a case officer in the station. That meant it was my job to handle assets and produce intelligence. But it also meant, more than anything else, that it was my job to hunt for new sources. Case officers are like sharks. They have to swim and hunt continuously. In the trade, everybody knows how to write an intel report and securely handle an asset. If you don't know how to do those kind of baseline things, you get sent home. What defines case officers is their ability to bring on new blood. In the trade, they say, 10% of the officers recruit 90% of the sources. Some people can do it. Many can't. Some can, but don't. Because the ethical baggage is too heavy. Sometimes sources you recruit end up dead. Sometimes they end up in jail. If you can't handle that fact, you need to find another line of work. Bottom line, if you want to be a case officer and get promoted, you hunt. I made contact one day with an individual who was an Islamic extremist and who was heavily involved with ongoing Al-Qaeda activity and terrorism. I won't go into the details here of exactly how I made contact with this individual. That's the kind of stuff that, no matter how you spin it, comes down to sources and methods that can't be talked about. In any event, I was successful in making contact with this individual. He had by this point been involved in Islamic terrorist activity for many years. He had attained a relatively senior position, wherein his primary function was moving money and support to those individuals actually doing the fighting. His next assignment was to go to Africa and work on establishing infrastructure there. This was less than a year before the 1998 embassy bombings in Nairobi and Dar es Salaam. My contact was ferociously anti-American. He was absolutely convinced that Western materialistic influence was destroying the Islamic world. He had, however, by this point, begun to have some serious misgivings about the amount of blood that was being spilled, the justification for violence, and the taking of innocent life. His experience had led him to believe that Al-Qaeda's methodology could not be justified under the teachings of Islam. He was torn. He was willing to talk. He was not sure what he needed or wanted to do now. He and I spent many days together. We debated. We philosophized. I worked overtime to help him reach the point at which he could accept that cooperating with CIA was justifiable and that it would mean saving lives. In the end, he remained in many ways an enemy of the United States, but he agreed to a clandestine relationship with CIA and became an asset of ours. He agreed to provide us information on the plans and intentions of the group to which he belonged. He agreed to work with us against his former associates. I set up follow-on meetings with him outside the country in which he had been recruited. It was, I thought, an extremely important case. I had barely finished the write-up on the recruitment, however, when I received a devastating series of messages from Washington. They had reviewed the case. They had decided that since this individual was technically a citizen of an allied nation, they did not believe we should continue the relationship with him. They had made the determination that it was more important to avoid offending this Middle Eastern government than it was to have a spy inside Al-Qaeda. Those messages almost floored me. They weren't completely out of character with what I knew already about headquarters and our counterterrorism efforts. Nonetheless, to have brought on a source with that degree of access and then to be told to cut him away was completely demoralizing. Just to complete the picture, a few days after 9/11, an officer from CIA Counterterrorism Center, CTC, came to find me at headquarters. We were now in a desperate rush to recruit penetrations of Al-Qaeda. Somebody had done a file search and tripped across my case. The officer from CTC wanted to know if I knew where my old source was now and whether I could help them make contact with him. It was one of those moments when you don't know whether to laugh or to cry. I reminded the officer from CTC that the source in question was a highly dangerous anti-American Islamic extremist. I reminded him that I had met with the source, always under a false name, and only in very carefully controlled meetings. In short, I reminded him that we had not kept in touch, that we did not exchange Christmas cards, and that I did not have him over for family barbecues. I had no idea where he was, although I was very confident that having been cut loose from us, by us, he was still out there working to our detriment. After 9/11, CTC went into overdrive. Nobody in Washington had a plan for what to do next. The Department of Defense locked up. The bureaucracy spun in circles, useless. It fell to a handful of individuals in CIA, like Hank Crumpton and Kofor Black, true names, to craft a strategy, sell the White House on it, and start deploying teams. At headquarters, I was still going crazy. I was pushing paper and attending meetings and working issues nobody cared about. Meanwhile, my fellow case officers, my peers, began choppering into Afghanistan, organizing native forces, and taking the fight to the enemy. I was in agony. Then the rumors started. This would have been around January 2002. We were going into Iraq. The decision had been made by the White House that we were going to do what we had threatened to do for years. We were going to take out Saddam. Step one in that plan was for CIA to put a team into northern Iraq to work with the Kurds and prepare the battlefield for the subsequent deployment of American military forces. I went upstairs to the floor where Iraqi Operations Group was located. I walked into the office of the Chief of Operations, who was a friend. I didn't volunteer for the job of leading the team that would go into Iraq. I demanded it. I had by this time in my career more experience in Kurdistan than virtually any other officer in CIA. I can't and won't go into all the details of how I acquired that experience. Many of those are operations we still can't talk about, even in general terms. Suffice it to say that I knew the area and the people well. I had led a number of different small teams on operations in the area over the course of several years. I had spent significant time in the mountains and villages of the area. I had worked with and knew the Kurdish people. I had spent years working the Iraqi problem as well. I had run assets cross-border into Saddam's Iraq, collecting on all of the top intelligence priorities. I knew well the history of Iraqi weapons of mass destruction, WMD, efforts, and had personally written hundreds of intelligence reports on the topic. I knew all too well how difficult an environment Kurdistan could be and how formidable the Iraqi security apparatus was. A great number of our Iraqi assets over the years were captured, tortured, and killed. Some of those had been men I recruited and sent into harm's way. Going into Iraq was not just getting back into the fight, it was personal. If we were finally going to finish Saddam and make him pay for his atrocities, I was not going to watch from the sidelines. I also knew the Turks and spoke Turkish. I had worked with them in the field closely, often deploying to remote areas for months at a time with Turks and special operations personnel. Any deployment of personnel into northern Iraq was going to go through Turkey, and having experience in dealing with that nation would be critical. The Turks can be a great people, and they are fierce fighters. They are not always the easiest to deal with. More than once in the field, I had butted heads with Turkish commanders who wanted to dictate terms to me rather than work with the men on my team as partners and allies. I laid all of this and more out for my friend, the Chief of Operations. He confirmed what I had heard. The White House had made the call. We were going to invade Iraq, and we were going to do it soon. It was January 2002. The White House wanted a CIA presence inside Iraq by March. A few officers from headquarters had already made a quick visit to Iraqi Kurdistan and met with senior members of the Barzani and Talabani clans. The Kurds were generally on board. The plan was to arm the Kurdish Democratic Party and Patriotic Union of Kurdistan forces in the north and then bring in special forces to work with them and train them. Eventually, conventional U.S. military forces would flow in as well, but the Kurds would be the force multiplier that, once armed with modern weapons, would tie down the Iraqi military in the north while the American military launched its primary invasion from Kuwait in the south. My friend, the Chief of Operations, said he would talk to his boss, the group chief. A couple of days later, we met again. I had the job. I was now the head of the team that would spearhead the invasion of Iraq. The team itself did not exist yet, but it would be formed up as fast as possible. Some of the likely members were already on hand at headquarters. Some others would be coming in shortly. Members of the 10th Special Forces Group from Fort Carson would be included. I was psyched. I had a real-world mission, and I would be in on the ground floor of a massive, and in my opinion, long-overdue military effort to unseat one of the world's most horrible and sadistic rulers. Only then did I ask what should have been one of my first questions. Since the key to this operation was arming the Kurds, since all arms to the Kurds had to transit Turkey, and since the Turks and the Kurds hated each other, what did Ankara think about our plan to send state-of-the-art weapons into northern Iraq? The response was not encouraging. We have not told the Turks yet, but we don't think it will be a problem. I sat, dumbfounded. All I could think was, then you don't know anything about the Turks. Chapter 2. The Plan. Just before my first meeting with the Chief of Operations in the Iraqi Operations Group, CIA sent a small team, no more than 4 individuals, into northern Iraq. They were in country for a matter of days, just long enough to have meetings with senior Kurdish leaders. These leaders included heads of the 2 principal Kurdish factions that had control of the Kurdish area in northern Iraq. These were the Kurdish Democratic Party, KDP, and the Patriotic Union of Kurdistan, PUK. These 2 parties had divided northern Iraq into 2 roughly equal areas, which operated effectively as independent nations. In the wake of the First Gulf War, 1990 to 1991, the United States imposed a no-fly zone over northern Iraq, which roughly corresponded to the mountainous northern part of the country, historically inhabited by the Kurdish people. With the U.S. flying air cover, the Kurds effectively governed northern Iraq. On a map, it was still Iraq. On the ground, it was Kurdistan. In the simplest possible terms, the KDP was built around the Barzani family, and the PUK was built around the Talibani family. The Barzanis were based in a family compound in the mountains above Erbil. The Talibanis were based in a similar compound in the mountains near Sulaymaniyah. Both families prized loyalty. Both families operated every day with the sure knowledge that they had to fight to survive, and that, as the saying goes, their only friends were the mountains. Both families could be decisive and deadly when necessary. It was a tough neighborhood. When the headquarters team met with the members of the Barzani and Talibani families in Iraq in the winter of 2002, they faced a great deal of skepticism. The United States did not have a great track record with the Kurds. We had, on multiple occasions, made noises about taking out Saddam and then walked away, leaving them to face the consequences. The Kurdish leaders who met with our team members posed some very direct and very pointed questions. They wanted to know if we were serious this time. To their questions, the Kurds received some very direct responses. Unfortunately, for American foreign policy in general, and for me in particular, many of the responses they received were at best misleading. We wrote a great many checks. It would remain to be seen whether or not we could cash all of them. The most immediate concern of the Kurds was armament. If the United States started making noises about taking out Saddam, there was a very real chance Baghdad might preemptively move into Kurdistan. The Iraqi army was large and heavily armed. The Kurds were a light infantry force. If they had to stand against the Iraqis on their own, they were going to have to head for the hills, literally, very quickly. In short, the Kurds wanted to see something concrete from us. Words were great, but they didn't kill Iraqis. The headquarters team assured the Kurds we understood. They told them we would give them all the arms they could handle. In particular, they promised to give them javelin anti-tank missiles. These were state-of-the-art weapons. Giving them to the Kurds would dramatically enhance their ability to stand up to Iraqi armor and hold their own. The Kurds asked all the predictable questions. Specifically, they wanted assurances that we would handle the Turks. They were told we would. They were also told the weapons in question would be coming in very soon. The president wanted to invade Iraq within a few months. CIA wanted the team on the ground by March. That team would then begin right away to bring in weapons in large numbers. The U.S. Army would not be far behind. Like I said, we wrote a lot of checks. I would be the guy who would be asked to cash them. When I took over as the team leader for the group that would go into Iraq, and while we were still identifying personnel who would be on the team, I began to try to put my hands around the planning that was underway and take ownership of all activity related to the impending deployment. That was easier said than done. There was no central authority within Iraqi Operations Group then working the problem. There were probably a dozen different people in different capacities in the group making decisions, without any kind of coordination, regarding the impending deployment. What I found as I began to make the rounds was, therefore, predictable. It was chaos. One of the first people I went to talk to was the logistics officer who had been on the headquarters team that went in-country to meet the Kurds. If I was going to take a team in-country with little or no support infrastructure behind it, I wanted the clearest possible idea of what we should take. What could we get there? What needed to be brought in? Had housing been identified? What about security? Would we be in a secure Kurdish compound or on our own? What vehicles were we going to use? Had they been purchased? If so, where were they? Bath mats. The logs officer was a woman. Those were her first words to me. Come again? Bath mats. The Kurds put us up in a very nice guest house, but the tile floors in the bathroom were cold in winter. You need bath mats. They did not have any. I ordered them already. They should be on the pallet at the logs center where they are pulling together the gear for your deployment. Thanks. I started wondering what else might be on that pallet. No one could tell me. I drove to the logs center to take a look. After a certain amount of confusion, I found the several air transport pallets that were being built at the logs center. By that I mean that our gear was being assembled onto pallets there. As I had feared, I determined that a whole bunch of people in the Iraqi operations group, without any coordination or any kind of organized thought process, had started ordering gear and having it sent to the logs center where it was all being put on pallets. With some help from some other personnel, I tore it all apart. We found the bath mats. Suffice it to say, they never went to Iraq. There were enough of them for five times as many people as we ever had in country. We found holsters. There were at least six different types of holsters, all purchased in large quantities. Some were shoulder holsters. Some were drop holsters. Some were ankle holsters. We left the bulk of them on the pallet, but probably should have tossed most of them. In my gear closet in my office today, I have three or four holsters from this deployment that were issued to me and are still in their original packaging. Unopened. We found tactical vests of all varieties and pretty much anything and everything you can imagine that was made of black Gore-Tex. If you could order it from a cool guy catalog and it looked high speed, somebody had purchased it with tax dollars and sent it to the logs center. Most of it never went in country. I went back to the ops chief. I was now the team leader. All gear going with the team would be chopped on by me. No more shopping sprees. He agreed. We started to get our hands around the problem. The only answer I could get about housing was that the Kurds would provide it. I was told basically not to worry about security. The Kurds would guarantee it. I knew the Kurds. I didn't doubt their ability. I did have a basic problem with the idea of going to bed every night trusting somebody else made sure I woke up alive. I determined that a number of vehicles had been purchased for use by the team in country. They had been purchased and were sitting in Turkey waiting for us. I asked what kind of vehicles and could not get an answer. Subsequently, I discovered they were all Jeeps bought from a dealership in Ankara. I asked if there were any Jeeps in Kurdistan and suggested that I doubted there were. I asked if anybody had thought to ask the Kurds what kind of vehicles would be best for use in country, both from the standpoint of blending in and maintaining them. No one had. People were tasked to buy four-wheel drives. They did so. End of story. We ended up using the Jeeps for our initial deployment and then quickly replaced them with Toyota Land Cruisers, which were everywhere in country, easily acquired and easily maintained. The Jeeps I relegated to using only inside the KDP compound where we were housed. I never saw another Jeep the entire time I was in country. They turned heads everywhere they went, beautiful vehicles, and a complete waste of money. Anybody who had spent 10 minutes in Kurdistan would have known to buy Land Cruisers. Bush wanted us in country within 60 days. Leaving aside the fact that we still didn't have a team, there was one massive impediment to that. We did not have Turkish approval to insert. At some point, this came down to geography. In 2002, Kurdistan, Iraqi northern Iraq, was landlocked and surrounded on all sides by hostile states. To the south, across what was called the Green Line, was territory under the control of Saddam Hussein. There were roughly 150,000 Iraqi troops lined up on this border. Nobody was getting into Kurdistan that way. To the east was Iran. Enough said. The Iranians were not friends, and they were not going to help. To the west was Syria. That was as bad as Iran. There was no way Assad was going to help us take down Saddam. He figured he was next on the list. That left Turkey. If we wanted to get into northern Iraq and sustain an effort there, we would need the approval of the Turks and their continuing support. Any organized, rational approach to getting this effort off the ground, therefore, would have started with high-level diplomacy between Ankara and Washington. Instead, we went about it in exactly the opposite manner. We made the decision to invade Iraq. We promised the Kurds everything they could possibly want in the way of arms and support. Then, almost as an afterthought, we went to the Turks to fill them in. I feel sorry for the people in Embassy Ankara who had to conduct the negotiations that then ensued. They were not pretty. The Turks weren't just skeptical about the idea of sending heavy weapons, including modern anti-tank missiles, to the Kurds. They were livid. They said, "No." Then they said it again. And again. At headquarters, I kept trying to explain, over and over, to anyone who would listen, what we were dealing with. Turkish opposition was not a minor thing, it was a deal-breaker. Without the Turks, there was no deployment, and we needed to focus the White House on this and get the senior-most levels of the U.S. government engaged to break the logjam. Most of that was wasted breath. The White House had ordered us in. Planning was to proceed. It was simply assumed that the Turks would change their minds and get on board, that we were asking them to do something that they considered highly detrimental to their national interest did not register. I was told to drive on and be ready to deploy. I did what you do in that kind of situation. I said, "Yes, sir," and went about assembling my team. Chapter 3. The Team. The initial idea was for our team to insert into Iraq no later than March 2002. That was critical, because it was the full intention of the White House to launch the invasion of Iraq by April. I did not attend meetings with the President myself. I was, however, briefed repeatedly by the Iraqi Operations Group Chief, who did. That meant we needed to get a team assembled and squared away ASAP. Theoretically, I had about 60 days before I was going to be taking these men, and potentially women, into Iraq and into harm's way. That left a lot of work to do. To understand the magnitude of the task in question, you need to understand something critical about CIA. There is no standard table of organization and equipment. If I ask an Army officer to break down the structure of a mechanized infantry platoon, he can tell me. He can tell me how many men, what ranks, what training they have had, what vehicles they operate and how many, what weapons they use, etc. There is no such thing in CIA. Every station is different. Every team is different. It means CIA is incredibly flexible. It also means when you tell CIA to pull a team off the shelf and deploy it, you are asking them first to build the team from the ground up. I was the team leader. Another experienced officer named Hans was named as my deputy. Unfortunately, Hans was posted to a field station abroad, and he had plenty of work to do there. Hans would later prove to be one of the most capable officers with whom I ever served. He was not particularly useful in building the team, because he was not at headquarters most of the time. He would periodically show up for a brief period, and then when it became clear that the Turks were still not on board and more delay was in the offing, he would have to return to his home station and his duties there. That the White House had ordered us in country to prep the way for a planned imminent invasion should have meant Hans would be relieved from his other duties and assigned full time to this project. It did not. It fell to me to organize the team. A number of other individuals began to be identified to deploy into Iraq. I will focus here on those who ended up being the eight who actually crossed into Iraq in the summer of 2002. Blue Falcon, case officer, the youngest of eight men, fluent in Arabic and of ethnic Arab descent. He had been a U.S. Marine and had been in Kurdistan before in 1991, after the first Gulf War. Fanatic Kid Rock and Britney Spears fan and class clown, worked in a bar in Georgetown on the weekends. I spent way too much time in a vehicle with Blue Falcon, suffering from his horrible taste in music. Sunshine, paramilitary officer. Big, powerful guy, former SEAL team operator, astonishingly competent, rock solid at all times. He was assigned to the team from Ground Branch, which is CIA's land warfare paramilitary force. Ground Branch personnel are typically seasoned veterans of U.S. elite special operations units. Uncle, case officer, another member of Ground Branch, former Marine officer, very bright, very capable, great sense of humor. The only man I know who actually eats Iranian ice cream and likes it. He did the lion's share of the work in putting together the plans to wipe out Ansar al-Islam's compound on the Iranian border in summer 2002. God knows how many Americans would be alive today if those plans had been implemented. Tim, case officer, another former SEAL, Arabic speaker, very bright and very capable. Like most SEALs, a fanatic about physical fitness. He was originally identified to stand up a separate team to work with PUK when headquarters began to focus on the fact that we would need more than one team to handle the territory in question. Despite that, when we crossed in the summer of 2002, there were only eight of us, and I was the team leader. In that configuration, Tim was my deputy. When we ultimately increased our numbers in fall 2002, we did split into two teams, and Tim took command of the team working with PUK. Pops, our communicator. Probably the most out of place. Pops had been in the army many years prior. Since then, he had worked as a communicator in large field stations in Asia. He had no prior experience working in small teams like the one we were building. He did a creditable job handling our commo, but struggled at times to deal with conditions and adapt to an environment that was very different than that to which he was accustomed. Dakota, case officer, a true Western cowboy, former Marine Scout sniper. Not technically a member of Ground Branch, but brought a lot of the same skills to the team. Great guy, and a great friend. He and I, in summer 2002, made one of the most significant recruitments of my career. Had already done time in Afghanistan before he joined my team. Bones, our team medic, technically belonged to CIA Medical Corps. In reality, he was more like another Ground Branch body. He had already been deployed to Afghanistan. Me, case officer. I had spent most of the last 13 years overseas running operations. I spoke Greek, Turkish, just enough Thai to get in trouble in Bangkok, and a little Kurdish. I had been both an armor officer and a JAG, Judge Advocate General's Corps, officer, in the U.S. Army. In addition to these individuals, there were probably another eight who were identified by February 2002 and participated in training for deployment. None of those were included in the first team that crossed the border, however. That was purely a political matter related to how many bodies the Turks ultimately agreed to let us send. On top of the CIA personnel who would deploy, we were told that members of the 10th Special Forces Group would be included. Specifically, we were told that a 6-man pilot team would accompany us in preparation for the movement of the entire group in-country sometime in spring 2002. Accordingly, I made a trip out to Fort Carson to meet with group leadership and the members of the pilot team. That team was to be led by Captain Sid Cruz. True name. Sid proved to be one of the most capable men with whom I have ever served. Sid and I remain great friends to this day. As I began to assemble my team, I focused on the next task. Organization. Iraqi Operations Group was pulling together bodies. They had no idea what all those bodies should do or how this team should be organized. Neither did I. But I sat down and got to work figuring it out. I drew up a wiring diagram breaking the larger team into individual sections, organized around tasks. I put in slots for myself as team leader and for a deputy, but otherwise kept the setup as flat as possible. We weren't going to Iraq to shuffle paper. We were going to run ops and win a war. I did not ultimately get a chance to fully stand up the organizational structure I had created until fall 2002, when we got sufficient personnel in country. In the meantime, though, it provided a framework within which we could manage personnel and train them. People were not any longer simply being told to report to headquarters and join the team. They were showing up, checking in with me, and then being briefed on what they would do and to whom they would report. The next step was training. The White House was still talking about deploying any day. The Turks still weren't cooperating. That left a bunch of very aggressive operators sitting around with not much to do and no fixed idea of when we would go live. I was also focused on the fact that, as experienced as many of the personnel were that we were getting, the CIA in general at the time was doing a poor job of preparing its officers to operate in the kind of area into which we were going. Training did not just mean putting these people through courses. It meant creating the courses first. Over the long decades of the Cold War, the CIA became very comfortable with conducting operations undercover in the civilized nations of the world. Its officers focused more and more on chasing other targets, also undercover, around the punch bowls of the world. In those kind of ops, things could still go wrong, but the price the CIA officer paid was typically being sent home early. I had fought against this culture from the beginning of my career. I had made a profession of proposing ops that my bosses dismissed as being too risky. Sometimes I won the argument and was allowed to proceed. Sometimes I lost the argument and was told to sit down and shut up. In all cases, I wondered, if it's too risky for us, then who's going to do it? We were in a different world now. 9/11 had made it impossible for the bureaucracy to continue business as usual. Ops that would have been dismissed as out of hand were now being approved routinely. I was being told to go into a remote, very dangerous part of the world and start a war. If so, I was going to make sure we were ready. The ground branch officers were designated to start up a program of regular training in what I considered to be essential skills. Nobody was excused, including me. We weren't going to have a team composed of folks who could handle themselves in an emergency and folks who were dead weight. Everybody was going to be able to take care of themselves. We began with basics. Personnel were put through map reading and orienteering training. Theoretically, everybody on the team should have been proficient in this. I wasn't taking any chances. We wandered around state parks in Virginia, honing our skills. We did basic handgun and rifle training. We shot a lot of holes in paper targets. Then I put the team on a plane and we went to a shooting school out west. As luck would have it, our lead instructor at the school was a legendary figure I will call Gunner. The school did not know who we were. They had been told that we were some sort of security team and had not inquired further. Gunner and I already knew each other, however. He had run a shooting course I had attended years before. I did not know Gunner was instructing at the shooting school until we arrived, but as soon as I saw him, I knew our cover was blown. I pulled Gunner aside and explained to him that we were a CIA team getting ready to deploy. I did not specify a location. He assumed Afghanistan. Nobody was even thinking about Iraq at the time. I let Gunner continue to believe that we were going to Afghanistan throughout the training. Only long afterward, when we had returned, did I talk to him about our real destination. He understood why I had kept it from him. He was a pro. Two of the officers I took to the shooting school were women. One was a logistics officer we called Mom. The other was a reports officer, someone who interfaces between case officers and analysts. We called Blondie. At the culmination of the training we did at the shooting school, we went through some pretty intense live-fire training in a shoot house. I had been through similar training before. Neither Mom nor Blondie had. Gunner came to me on the last day of training, when everyone would have to navigate the shoot house successfully to graduate. He said he did not think it was safe to put either Mom or Blondie through the house. He said they were both unsafe, and that the chances of somebody getting shot and killed were too high. Both Mom and Blondie believed then, and probably believe now, that Gunner was being sexist. I'm not so sure. I think he was making the call he thought was right, based on a lot of years of training people to shoot and having forgotten more about firearms than I will ever know. In any event, both of these women were vital members of my team. I needed them, and I needed a bunch of disparate people to start being a team. They could fail, and I could still take them in country. That was my call. It would not change the fact that in the eyes of their teammates, they would not have pulled their own weight. I told Gunner I would go through the shoot house with both.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.